I have made my views on the ether well known, not only to the Royal Society, but also to the universities. The ether is a physical thing. Now, how do we find it? That is the task.
This is the SS Maui, 720 feet long, 30,000 horsepower, 22 knots. For 13 years, I carried out revolutionary weather engineering experiments from her flying bridge. Let's look at a fast montage of some of the gear that I used, and then we'll go right to work using it so you can see it happen. Right from zero. This is the Black Widow. It consists of a PVC tube of specific length with an associated lined metal cone. Here is another version of it. They are simple projectors of etheric force. The relationships are all geometric between the cone and the tube. Any cone, such as this one here, is a projector of etheric force. So are these bazookas, which do not use cones, but which utilize layering arrangements to produce potential differentials in the ether. There are many variants. This is the termite. It's called the termite because it literally bores into the ether as it rotates and the vessel moves. It generates an etheric vortex. Here is another of those termites, a different size. There are many variants of the termite.
This is the 4x4, about the size of a coffee cup. This is the Box Apache. It is a basic generator of etheric vortices. Those two truncated cones are manifolded into an etheric energy accumulator. This is Irv Trent's skimmer. Simpler than the simplest transistor radio, yet capable of generating rain under conditions of a high barometer. You'll see it working. Here are a couple of skimmers attached to a rotating bar. This is called a spider skimmer. Like the skimmer, it raises Hob in the atmosphere. Some of these devices, as you can see from my hand, are very small indeed. This is the Matterhorn, two tonally tuned chambers. This gets you into the ether and causes the ether to react with this device as you move and rotate it. This is the spider, a generator of vertical etheric vortices. This is capable of surrounding a moving vessel with rain or near rain conditions. Here is a spider operating below decks. They work just the same, no matter how much steel you put around them. If you happen to be a physics professor, this is going to blow your mind. Here is a similar device working on a flying bridge horizontally. There are many variants of these geometric assemblies. All of them aim at creating vortices in the ether, and an implosive etheric vortex will produce rain regardless of the barometer. All of these units are descended from the original projectors, like this one, the Black Widow. Going out fore and aft along the keel line of the vessel, and we are moving at 22 knots. This is in March of 1985. The Maui is on that short portion of her course where she travels in a direct magnetic west direction. There is a colossal globe-girdling flow of subtle etheric force flowing from west to east in temperate latitudes. We are now going directly into that gigantic flow. Very subtle. We are opposing that flow locally with the output from the Black Widow on the flying bridge above us. The output from the Black Widow opposes the oncoming west-to-east flow of ether, causing it to back up. This is just like turning a hose into a stream of water coming down a gutter. You back it up. The etheric potential rises and causes atmospheric water vapor to accrete where this happens. But the ether is an elastic force despite its subtlety, and so it springs away from this temporary local compression. That is what you're seeing now. Let's do it over from 12 minutes to make sure that you caught that. The compression continues, just like pushing down on a block of rubber. This, of course, is immeasurably more subtle. The compression continues, denser and denser it gets,
finally the elasticity of the etheric force takes over, and the whole dam springs away while we watch and goes right over our heads. By damming this force locally, we have caused the west-to-east flow to recoil within itself farther back over the horizon towards the west. This is the thing that is going to change the weather in this region. You can already see showers forming there to the left of the jackstaff. The subtle but majestic ether flow over the ocean area to the west of us has now been significantly upset. This is leading to turbulence. You can see it begin to build. And remember, please, that we are rushing directly to the west right now at 22 knots. Thousands of hours of empirical work were necessary to find out how to do this. Now it's easy. This is classic stuff, and that is the reason that we are including it, even though it is now 7 years old at the time this tape is being recorded. No doubt whatever about the change. A regional upset has been initiated. As we're past the 1 hour mark now, we can see the carpet of rain begin moving across the surface of the sea towards us. And there you have it. In a little more than an hour, you saw us go from this to this. That's engineering the ether. In the tropics, another colossal planetary flow of ether travels from east to west. That's where we are now, facing east. This is the horizon on a typical March day in 1985. And we are going to change that with two bazookas and two of the Black Widow-type devices. We are going to interdict the east-to-west flow, which is coming from the right of the screen here, and we're going to transform this day. Now you can see for yourself what happens in the space of 40 minutes. First of all, the small local clouds begin to go bananas. The greater effect begins to appear far beyond at the horizon, where we are again looking at that damming effect of the ether. We have 1025 millibars, so it's not rainy weather. As the dam increases, so does the amount of water vapor accreting. We've got this effectively blocked. The potential goes up to the point where discharge takes place, and you have rain where none was before. And at 40 minutes, the scene is transformed. You've seen it happen from zero now, twice.
Weather Engineering required only 40 minutes to take you from this tranquil forenoon scenario
to this. Not magic and not metaphysics, just engineering.
The people who keep saying that there is no ether have a soulmate who hangs out down at the Turtle Bay Hilton Hotel on the island of Oahu in Hawaii. He says the same thing.
No ether, no ether, no ether, no ether, no ether, no ether, no ether.
Winter conditions prevail in this sequence made early in March of 1985. Once again, we are using four of the Black Widow and bazooka-type devices, passive devices with no moving parts and no motion. They are passive, save for the motion of the vessel through the water, which means through the ether also. In the winter months, a flow of etheric force comes out of the north towards the south. Our camera is now facing magnetic north, the source of this flow. It is insufficient strength right now to permit us to dam it up and give you the same type of demonstration of etheric engineering as we have in the previous two sequences. This flow is coming from north to south under meteorological conditions, a high barometer, and dry air, unlikely to produce or permit rain. Now you see the force begin to dam up and the atmospheric water vapor run to the area of high ether potential. You see it first in the foreground and it passes over us almost immediately, as in the two previous sequences. Further back, on the northern horizon, the main effect of our engineering activity becomes increasingly evident. With each time exposure frame, the energy intensifies, the water vapor concentration increases, and we begin to see rain pillars forming everywhere. It is now raining. The rain is advancing on us. We have a carpet of rain coming down on us, and obviously it's going to hit the vessel. There it is. This is what the scenario looked like about a half hour ago when we started this experiment. This is what we wound up with. The sequences that you have seen up to this point were made in the middle 1980s, without too much attention being paid to barometric pressure. It was, so to speak, the beginning of the modern period of this work on the high seas. Around 1988, we decided not to do any rain engineering unless we had a high barometer. If we did not have high pressure, we didn't even try to engineer rain. Only weather engineers, using the ether, can perform this feat, which is completely beyond the capacities of the orthodox meteorologists. We also felt that we had to do it many times, pressed down and running over,
so there was no doubt whatever that it really could be done and was happening.
Here we are at the noon hour, in the middle of the Pacific. Does this look like high pressure to you? You're right. As a matter of fact, it's 1023 millibars, and we're going to give you a look at the ship's barometer to verify that that's what it is. There it is, 1023. Good solid pressure. And we've got a three degree differential between wet and dry, so the air is nowhere near saturated. Now let's take a look at what's around us, and then let's see what's doing it. Starboard side, rain. Probably 40 degrees of that horizon or more, 60, 80 degrees is raining right now. More rain on the beam. Rain all the way down there to the south. And around behind us, heavy cloud with the portent of more rain. This is with 1023 millibars. Now, what could be producing such a meteorological outrage? That's one of them, the square 4 termite, the size of a coffee mug, but very precise. The rain is there, and over on the starboard side, the tune structure that we call the Matterhorn, lending its strength to our work. Everything is geometric in dealing with the ether. Here is the Navy map, an hour later. This is the latest map received by Radiofax. It's for 1800 Zulu today, the 12th. The Maui is right there, the red chip, en route from Honolulu to Oakland. The major weather feature is that big high in the upper left corner, 1033 millibars, and it's rotating clockwise like that. That creates a very tranquil, totally rainless system for the Maui, according to all classical reckoning, right there where we are now. But let's leave those two beasties that we showed you cooking away up there for a couple of hours. It's now 2:12 p.m. Let's see if they can sustain their effects over the period of the afternoon and take a look at a later time. At 4:56 p.m., the rain is still there. Over there to starboard, on the starboard bow there, dead ahead, and around to port, the north. Heavy cloud accreted, rain pillars there, camera center now, 1023 millibars, more rain pillars over there to the west. This looks more like Puget Sound in January than mid-Pacific in a high-pressure cell. This is engineering. It is not metaphysics and it's not magic, and that is real rain. Of course, it takes time to experiment with all these things and to bring them down to the point where they can be quickly shown in a tape of this kind. This rain is a real-world happening. My oldest associate, Irwin Trent, known as Irv Trent, is a man who loves to dabble and dive into the magic and the mysteries of numbers and angles. He came up with a device that we call the skimmer. This here little beast is a skimmer. It's virtually identical to the one that Irv Trent first put together back in 1989, and you can see how simple it is. Two concentric cones in a PVC sleeve here, an attachment so that it can go on a motor shaft, and we have one of our little etheric power units in the middle. And that's all there is to a skimmer. It's simpler by far, than the simplest transistor radio. Am I kidding you about this? Let's take a look at the first time we tested Irv Trent's skimmer.
There it is, the skimmer. Its first operational test on the 31st of March, 1989. Now, what are the classical parameters of this situation in which we're using it? Let's take a look at a Navy map and find out what's going on in this part of the Pacific. This is how the eastern North Pacific looked 4 or 5 hours ago. The red chip there is the Maui en route from Honolulu to San Francisco. Right there, and under the influence of this high pressure system, this double high pressure system here above it to the north, the lazy circulation clockwise like that, it dominates the whole area. The flow around it is so lazy and there's so little behind it that your chances of getting any rainfall where we are are minuscule, virtually zero. But let's go up and take a look at how the skimmer is doing after we check the barometer. There we have it. 1021, that's a good pressure. We have a 4-degree differential between wet and dry bulbs, so the atmosphere is nowhere near saturated. Meanwhile, right across our bow, incontrovertible evidence of rain, right on our track. And there is how the skimmer, operating fore and aft, fits its geometry into this scenario. A little over an hour later, the skimmer has the whole forward horizon in an uproar. Rain pillars everywhere, and a totally changed scenario. This was our introduction to a remarkable device.
Will the skimmers work when they're not on a ship? A moving ship? Can you use them ashore in a fixed base application? You bet you can. Here's just a brief clip of some rain made down in Malacca, in Malaysia, in the summer of 1991 in their dry season. This is shoreside skimmer rain. My associate, Lou Matta, chief engineer of the SS Maui, is a geometrician of great insight and ability. He came up with a unit that we call the Box Apache. Let me show you that unit now.
The Box Apache consists of two golden section cones which are truncated. They are manifolded into an etheric energy accumulator. That's the base. Each apex is fitted with a matching section, that tubular section there that's attached to each apex. As the device rotates, as the vessel moves, the emission from this assembly is in the form of two beams of ether. These are tangible to the touch. You can actually feel them with the palm of your hand. These are emitted, and as the vessel progresses, twisting the ether in this form, you create vortices. These vortices are in the ether, but they inevitably translate into the atmosphere. And if you are generating implosive vortices, rain appears regardless of the barometer. That's a thumbnail sketch of how a box Apache works. And this is the first one that we built before we even painted it.
Now we're continuing our saga of rain engineering in dry, high weather. Here on the 23rd of April, 1989, it's a Sunday, beautiful day outside, and the time right now, 4:38 p.m. The red ship that you see here is the Maui, as she is at present. She's in this 1032 millibar high. There's the center there. The rotation is this way. The Maui is heading in this direction down towards Hawaii here, from Oakland over here on this course. Now with a circulation like this and a pressure this high, you shouldn't be seeing any rainfall here. Not at all. Now let's take a look at the barometer on our way out on deck.
We've got a solid 1026 millibars here. That is not a rain barometer. And lo and behold, right out there on the bow, engineered rain. And there's the culprit, the Box Apache, operating implosively, and here's the rain, right up on magnetic west, where it shouldn't be. When the responding ether locks itself into a pattern that is due to the equipment upon the traveling ship, that pattern of gross meteorological effects occurs regardless of the existing surface weather. The best aid we have in establishing that this happens is, of course, radar. Let's take a look at an example of this kind of thing.
This is a photograph of the collision avoidance system of the SS Maui, taken on the 30th of April, 89. Now, the collision avoidance system gets its information from the Maui's radar. So everything you see here has been derived from the Maui's 3-centimeter radar. This red dot here, which I have stuck on the photograph, that represents the Maui. That's her at the center of the screen, that red chip. This dotted line here is her course line from Honolulu to San Francisco. This circle represents the ocean area around the Maui with a radius of 24 miles. So this circle actually has a diameter of 48 miles. An important clue here to what is going on is this sea clutter out in this direction from the Maui. That is caused by the vessel's headwind coming in on this bearing. Any experienced deck officer in a merchant marine, any experienced naval officer will tell you that this sea clutter gives you a clue to the existence of about a 20 knot wind coming in this direction. So the Maui actually has a good stiff breeze going this way, and she is herself going this way at 20 knots or better. Look at this rain formation here extending up here like this at right angles to our course. A considerable amount of moisture. Millions and millions of tons of water are coming down out of this as we go. But we did not leave this barrier behind. We towed this barrier with us across the Pacific for at least 80 miles that evening before it began to dissipate after midnight, when there is a definite change in the etheric forces going on.
This is a typical example of the way in which radar, from the earliest days of this work, provided us with crystal clear, objective guidance as to just exactly what was going on.
Let's talk about another type of weather engineering device. If you take a couple of golden section cones, like these, and you place them apex to apex, like so, you lock them into a PVC sleeve so that they can't move, and then you rotate the whole assembly, you have what we call a termite. Now this here is our smallest version of the termite. At least it's the smallest we have made and used. It's called a 4x4 because it is 4 inches in diameter and 4 inches long. It attaches to a motor shaft through this pulley here. As you can see by comparing it with the size of this adjacent coffee cup, and we've got a couple of those fellas from the Turtle Bay Hilton on this to remind us that there is no ether. This is how this device looks. This is machined out of a solid rod of aluminum, precision machined by Lumata, and whether or not you believe it, this particular 4x4 termite is like all other termites. It will generate rain where rain shouldn't ought to be. Let's take a look.
This is the Navy Western Oceanography Center surface map for 4 o'clock this morning, 1200 Zulu. And this shows the position of the Maui here, this red ship, en route from Los Angeles on a great circle to Honolulu here in blue Hawaii. The Maui is now inside the influence of this 1030 millibar high pressure system here, which is quasi-stationary, rotating this way so that we have the wind on our starboard side. Now there is not much prospect here with a system of this intensity for rain to be here, but let's go out on deck now and take a look at the real world at 1:40 p.m. on the high seas.
We have a 1 degree temperature differential, so we are not saturated, and we have a good stout barometer, 1021 millibars. But as we look out here through the south and the southwest in this supposedly dry area with a high barometer, we find rain, lots of it, heavy pillars right across the port side. How did it happen? Here is the culprit, the termite square 8. Slow rotation, about 2 RPM. Vortex generation by this device and its companion on the other side have created the rain that you see over there to port in such profusion. And here on the other side is the termite 135, turning at 1.5 RPM, a gentle vortex in front of us. Termite vortex generators can put rain where none is supposed to be. Engineering. We are confronting here on the 13th of May, 1989, a virtually impossible situation for making rain where the Maui is, right there at the arrow. She's in the middle of a vast high-pressure system there with a center pressure of 1035 millibars. It's a real solid one, covers a couple of million square miles. From where the Maui is, the circulation, of course, is clockwise like that. The system is well integrated and solid, and you would have, with that type of center pressure, virtually no chance of rain right there where we are. But let's take a look at the thermometers and the barometer before we go up to see what's really happening outside, where there's not supposed to be, classically, any rain. 1025 millibars. A good solid pressure, not a rain pressure. There's a good temperature differential there. We're nowhere near saturation. Out on deck, what do we find? We find liberal rain all along our starboard side, where it shouldn't be according to the parameters of meteorology. There's a lot of water coming down out of that. millibars. This is etheric vortical action induced by man, translated into gross weather phenomena. Spider units are our most effective generators of etheric vortices. These are lineal descendants, actually, of Lou Matta's original Box Apache. Let's take a look at a spider now. The spider got its name from the way it looks when you assemble it. You can see how the name came about. This is the Mark 10 spider. 10 beams of etheric force being rotated, as you see here, stirring the ether into vortices.
In 1990, we operated 14 spider units in Southern California against smog, filing the project in advance with the federal government. The result was the lowest smog of all time, including the 2 years since. It all began on the Maui. The spider was proved out on the Maui long before it was used ashore against smog. Master mariners who have been observing weather for over 40 years were truly astounded at what they saw happen.
It is 11:30 a.m. 11:30 a.m. on the 24th of November, 1989. This is the situation in the eastern North Pacific at 1200 GMT today, and it is received from the U.S. Navy Meteorological Facility at Pearl Harbor. Here is the Pacific coast of North America here. Here are the Hawaiian Islands, and here is the track of the Maui from Honolulu over to Seattle, Washington. The dominant weather system this morning is this high-pressure system, 1024 millibars, covering a very large extent of the Pacific Ocean. Here is the Maui, very close to the center of this high and proceeding in this direction here. Now, conventional meteorological opinion would not give you much chance of having rain in this position at this time, especially considering how dry it is here. But let's go out on deck and see the real world reality and take a look at the thermometers and the barometer as we go.
Barometer shows us that we have plenty of pressure here. The thermometers show an astonishing 11 degrees Fahrenheit difference. That is not a rain indicator. Merciful heaven, we are in the middle of the ocean with less than 50% relative humidity, according to our hygrometer. And what do we have here at 11:40 a.m.? I do believe that across our bow is some engineered rain. Notwithstanding less than 50% relative humidity, or the high barometer. There are the pillars, but they are not alone. Right across in front of us, in a fashion typical of induced implosive activity, there are rain pillars. If you can get the ether to do what you want, you can do almost anything.
I have here Bill Moore, third mate of the Maui. He's been on watch this morning while this has been accreting. What about it, Bill?
Well, it started out early, 8 o'clock, before 8 o'clock, with nothing on the horizon, no rain, no hopes of any rain. And, we've got rain on a 360-degree span now. She's all the way around the clock.
10-22 millibars.
And we got a high barometer, and we've got low humidity, we've got less than 50% humidity, and it's very unusual.
Never seen this before?
Never before this ship.
Yeah.
We got a 10 degree spread on the temperature, wet and dry.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be any rain anywhere, any place in the town.
How long have you been going to sea, Bill?
About 40 years.
That's good many years,
yeah.
Thanks very much. Bill Moore.
You're welcome.
The tendency of any well-tuned spider is to surround the speeding vessel with rain, 360 degrees. Rain or near rain, that's what you usually see. Sometimes it's heavy, sometimes it's light. The barometer doesn't make much difference. This phenomenon intimately connects with the implosive character of the continuous vortex that's being generated. Radar is of aid, especially at night, in showing how this works. Here is a typical radar scenario with the spider in action. We've got the Mark IV functioning at this particular time. The weather conditions are not conducive to rain at all. The Maui is right at the center of our scope here, right at the very center. That bar going around is anchored to the Maui. That is her, the spot in the middle of your screen. And in a moment we will turn out that time escutcheon there so that we can watch the progress of everything here. To see that immediately adjacent to the Maui, within those inner rings, there is no rain. All the rain is around the Maui in a ring, just like you saw in that surface shot with the Mark 10. That's the way it works. Now, with the time out of the way there in the lower right, you can see the extent and the magnitude of the rain echoes that are being generated by this device. Now, we do not pass through that rain. It simply accompanies us in a fixed position. This is another reason why radar is so valuable to us. Sir Isaac Newton once wrote in a letter to Robert Boyle that he supposed that the pores of all material substances must contain some type
of subtle essence.
Certainly that is a pregnant thought from one of scientific history's greatest men. Trouble is, nobody seems to have followed it up, except me. If Newton was right, then the ether ought to go right through steel. A challenging thought. But it's not enough, ladies and gentlemen, to think about these things. You must act. I put one of our simplest etheric vortex generators 6 decks down, below the waterline aboard the Maui, with nothing less than 1/2 inch of marine steel between that vortex generator and the outside atmosphere. Do you think that the steel stopped it, or that the ether couldn't recognize the informational input from the generator? Let's take a look at what was truly an historic moment.
It's necessary to go through a couple of watertight doors to get to this beast.
The ocean is immediately through that steel. You're within 18 inches of the ocean where this thing is rotating. And as far as the etheric force is concerned, the steel does not exist. This is a major finding in the operation of these devices. If I go over here and show you this wall here, this is the skin of the vessel. On the immediate side of this half-inch steel plate, the ocean is to be found. You're actually below the waterline at this point. So this unit is, to all intents and purposes, operating below the surface of the sea, and the pickup of etheric force from it is very, very large.
Today we are testing the beast in the basement. He is surrounded by nothing less than 1/2 inch of marine steel. He's under this foredeck in front of us here. He's turning now, and we're going to put this thing into time lapse and let you see an etheric vortex generator create rain here in 1018 millibars. We're on the southern periphery of a large high with a center pressure of 1035 millibars. You'll notice that the scenario as it unfolds is reminiscent of those early day 1985 sequences we showed you at the commencement of this production. The vortex generator is in function here, and it is paying no attention to the seeming steel barrier. And there you are, in 30 minutes, the beast in the basement has shown that the ether penetrates steel, just as Sir Isaac Newton surmised. The beast is right underneath this foredeck here, on the left side, about 30 feet underneath the steel. Surrounded by steel, encased in steel. It doesn't mean a thing.
Today's date, down there in the right-hand corner, 2nd of December 1990, in local time here, 1:15 p.m. In front of you is the Pearl Harbor Navy Western Oceanographic Center map for this morning,
02-1200 Zulu, that's Greenwich time. Here is the Pacific coast of the United States here, the Maui coming out along this green line. And down here, within reach of Hawaii right there, let's straighten them up a little bit. Here is Honolulu here, we're just coming into Honolulu, but the dominant feature in the Pacific today is this high pressure system here, 1034 millibars. And this is rotating in this direction, and we are under its influence here. We have about 1017, 1018 millibars here where we are. And theoretically, there is nothing here on the map to indicate that we should be having rain. We do, however, have the beast operating in the basement, and we want you to see exactly what happens in the real world when that thing is in function. Let's go up now, take a look at the barometers and the thermometers on the way up.
The thermometers show 72 and 75. So we're not anywhere near saturation, and the hygrometer confirms that with a relative humidity reading of 82% there on the right. So there's no real indication of rain here, especially when the barometer is over 30 inches at 1017 millibars. Not a rainy situation. Up on deck, it certainly looks as though the beast has failed us. Who could imagine there being rain in a scenario like this? But the beast does not disappoint us. There's a deluge on our starboard quarter. A good solid one. Nothing light about that rain. It's over on the other side, too. And there it is, immortalized on radar. Those are the big splotches of rain there. On the right-hand side of the picture, the Maui is at the center. Implosive activity initiated by a device operating through a minimum of a half inch of marine steel. That's what I call engineering.
This business of engineering rain when the barometer is high is a tough enough business when everything is in your favor. But that is not always the case. Now, only a few people can do this. Certainly, the federal government can't and the Defense Department can't, but it can be done. But what about if you throw in three more toughening factors into this equation? Let's suppose that we have the wind astern of us, blowing on the stern from behind us. Let's suppose that we have a following sea. And to top it all off, let's suppose that we're down in subtropical latitudes where the main ether flow there is from east to west, so that even that is going at about the same speed as the ship. What about making rain under high pressure conditions with all those other things against you as well? It can be done. It has been done. Here's a well-documented example.
Recapitulating in graphic form, we need a high barometer, very dry air, a following wind, a following sea, the tropical east-to-west ether flow coming from behind us, from astern. In short, nothing in the whole scenario favoring rainfall. We have just such a scenario. The circumstances arise on the 23rd of October, 1989, and our local time is 1:50 p.m. as we look at this. This is the United States Navy surface map for today, about 4 o'clock this morning, San Francisco time. This is the situation in the Pacific. That time there is in Greenwich. There is the Pacific coast of North America. And the Maui is outward bound from San Francisco. She's there, on her way down to the Hawaiian Islands there. The weather situation is dominated by this gigantic, extremely high-pressure system. It's well over 2,000 miles in diameter. It has a center pressure of 1032 millibars. With that circulation around it coming behind us and putting the wind on our stern, and the sea on our stern, we have no chance whatever of having rain there. This is confirmed by our thermometers, a 10-degree differential, and our hygrometer, only 52% relative humidity, and a 1021 millibar barometer. Outside, on deck, in the real world, where there's not supposed to be any rain, early in the afternoon here, after some preparatory work, we have been able to induce a certain amount of rainfall. This is not the full gallon, as we say, but it is rainfall occurring under highly unlikely circumstances, in high pressure with extremely dry air. You've seen the map yourself, so you're in no doubt as to the situation where we are now moving at 22 knots towards Honolulu. Radar confirms with those spots there. There's the Maui indicated by the arrow. Those spots down in the lower part of the picture are rain return echoes. Now we let a few hours go by. It's shortly before 4 p.m. that same day. We have been working away all afternoon in getting this built up. And you can see there across our bow the beginning form of an exceptional barrier of rain. This is a no-nonsense, undeniable accretion, and we are going to watch it in successive stages as it develops. Here we are at 4:28 p.m., and it's more massive than ever, and obviously gaining in density. The reason that the density builds up is that the etheric potential is being made to rise in front of us. And wherever you can get the etheric potential to rise, moisture appears as though from nothing. So that even with less than 60% relative humidity, you are getting large masses of cloud to accrete. Over there, on the starboard side, is that tuned tonal chamber that we call the Matterhorn. A small device to be raising, or contributing to the raising, of a ruckus like this. But everything is ratio, proportion, and geometry. Size hardly counts at all. Did you think you saw some ether coming off that? Behind us, astern of us, the smoke is going straight up and you have a normal, high-pressure day. Exactly the kind of weather that you would expect to see here, judging from that Navy map. But as you come around forward of the beam, on the port side, it's obvious that the rain is accreting ahead of us. This barrier is now well distributed in the forward hemisphere. To the experienced weather engineer's eye, there is no doubt that this is going to rain considerably. It's now 4:30. and we leapfrog to 4:50, a scant 20 minutes, and look at the difference. It's leaking all over the place, all the way from the starboard beam, right around to the other side. We take a sweep behind us to let you see that the original high-pressure day is still there in our rear hemisphere. But as soon as we come around there onto the port side and get into the southerly quadrants, there is the rain. Plenty of it. And obviously gaining momentum and intensity. We have had a 5-degree drop in the temperature differential in the last hour as a result of all this rain coming down all over the place.
It's an interesting sidelight to what's going on here. And this is that in conventional meteorology and in conventional weather engineering, using chemicals and high-frequency radiation, other destructive, life-negative things, they can't do these things. Now, if they can't do these things and I can, I must know something that they don't. I must be doing something in the right way. Otherwise, there would be no results. There would be no results, like the old guard has to show, in any type of effort to duplicate what I'm doing here. They can bring out the whole of the Army and Navy if they want to, use as many men as they like, squash some more of those public dollars that reach them so easily through the Treasury. But they won't be able to do this. An interesting sidelight on a decadent culture.
At about 8 minutes before 5 p.m. on this spectacular afternoon, we have rain all the way across the bow. Lots of it. Rain that we can confirm for you right now on radar. There is our radar, and it doesn't lie. Those blobs at the bottom of the screen and in the left quadrants are what you just saw visually. All this without the use of chemicals or electromagnetic radiation. This is the empirical beginning of a new era in which the ether will become recognized as the source of all living pulsation. For mankind, there can truly be no new age until the ether is admitted to human affairs in all its majesty and grandeur. Goodbye from the Maui.